were people who didn't believe in any gods whatsoever in antiquity. In Athens from the 420s or so onwards, we can see people who are genuine atheists in the modern sense, and we can also see compendia of arguments against the existence of gods later on.
It's Friday, February 12th, 2016, and you're listening to the Armchair Atheism Podcast. I'm your host, Taylor Carr, and in this episode of the show, I talk with classicist and author Tim Whitmarsh about atheism in the ancient world. Most of us can probably name some famous atheists from the Enlightenment and preceding generations, but how far back does unbelief really go? What did it mean to be a non-believer long ago, and what does understanding the longevity of atheism tell us today? But first, a few updates and announcements are in order. If you have not joined our Facebook page, you can find it at facebook.com/godlesshaven and be easily connected with most of the content I produce, be it new podcast episodes, new articles, or new videos. I have also set up a Patreon page at patreon.com/godlesshaven, where you can make any donation you'd like to support the work I do, such as this very show you're hearing now. Last but not least, I have finally managed to get this podcast onto iTunes, so those who have had difficulty finding the show or keeping it in their feed can breathe a sigh of relief. Before we move on to the interview with Professor Whitmarsh, be aware that there will be a slightly awkward fade and transition during the discussion. Unfortunately, the call got lost for a brief time while recording. I did some editing to keep things relatively smooth, but luckily about 99% of the interview is still intact. So without further ado, I hope you enjoy the show. Tim Whitmarsh is a British classicist and the A.G. Leventis Professor of Greek Culture at the University of Cambridge. He works on all areas of Greek literature and culture, specializing particularly in the world of Greeks under the Roman Empire. Professor Whitmarsh has published several books, including Greek Literature in the Roman Empire, Narrative and Identity in the Ancient Greek Novel, and his most recent, Battling the Gods, Atheism in the Ancient World. Tim, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much. It's a real pleasure.
So first of all, it might be interesting to get you started on talking about what got you interested in the study of ancient cultures, specifically the ancient Greeks.
Well, when I was very young, sort of 8, 9, 10, I lived in a very old part of England, which was... had a castle that was pre-Norman conquest, so pre-1066, and I used to find this absolutely captivating, this place. I used to go there pretty much every day whenever I could, and it was that sense of just wonder. That, I mean, it's all kind of romantic naivety and so forth, but it was that sense of wonder at the, how things that were created so long ago could still be in our landscape and still be relevant to us now that captivated me. I was also obsessed with ghosts, I have to say. We lived in a haunted house, or supposedly a haunted house, which had a Catholic priest's hidey hole in it from the time of the persecution of the Catholics in England as well. And that was kind of kooky as well. So lots of stuff about memories of the past and the way in which the past interacts with our world.
Very interesting. Have you actually had the privilege of visiting any of the ancient sites or ruins in Greece or Rome?
Yeah, I've been a lot. I mean, more to Greece than to Italy. I'm a specialist in ancient Greece, but I think I've probably been to Greece maybe 4 times in the last 2 years or whatever. I go there an awful lot, and I absolutely love it. I love the sites. I find them immensely powerful. I mean, knowing things about them and knowing, every time you go, you learn something different about them. But also, I love the people. I love the culture as well, and I don't speak modern Greek as well as I should do, for somebody who speaks but I read ancient Greek pretty well, but yes, I do love Greece.
Do you have a favorite site or I guess ruin or building that you've gotten to visit?
Ooh, that's I really
like asking you to choose between your children.
I mean, it's so, okay, so if I were saying, if the question were, where would you go for your first visit to Greece, my answer would be inevitably Athens, because Athens is such a sensational, wonderful city. Thessaloniki is also a great city, and Thessaloniki still have the city walls that were created in late antiquity and so forth, and it still feels as if it's still kind of visibly structured by the ancient remains. But there are so many wonderful sites, so many sort of little out of the way places. I remember I was recently on the island of Icaria, which is not a well-known tourist destination, and you can wander up to the peak of Byzantine castles where, and you can see absolutely nobody up there, and you see for miles around, and it's extremely dangerous because if you take a false step you're tumbling down the hillside, things like that. It's just such a wonderful place to visit ancient sites.
Yeah, my fear of heights might keep me away from some place like that.
Well, but I'm not good with heights either, actually. I'm not good with flying, and I'm not good with heights. And when you fly to Icaria, you fly with Aegean Airlines. It's Olympic Airlines, and their frequent flyers club is called Icarus. Okay, I don't know if you've even heard of Daedalus and Icarus. So the whole experience for me was rather terrifying, but really rewarding, massively rewarding.
So how did you actually come into researching and writing about atheism in antiquity?
Well, it was a mixture of my classical interests, and I mean, I did feel as if there was a gap in the market for a book on ancient atheism. The study of Greek religion, I find, immensely rewarding. What the Greeks thought about their gods is one of these endlessly fascinating topics, because there are so many diverse ideas, because they're not a culture that have a Bible, and they certainly aren't a culture that have, you know, a papacy or something that decides what the correct way of interpreting the Bible is. So they have, you know, a diverse range of beliefs about the gods, including there are a number of people in antiquity who, as the book, this is what the book is essentially about, are a number of people in antiquity who don't believe in gods at all. So I did think there was a sort of an academic gap there as well, but it's also, I mean, clearly a personal thing. I was brought up Catholic and am now an atheist, but I'm not a kind of holler in your face atheist. I'm not one of the people, you know, I'm just endlessly interested in questions about what people actually believe about the world around them and what's not in the world around them.
So today, on that subject, actually, religion is often very bound up with morality, as we see in the West, and seeks to prove that it can coexist with and even complement science. That's kind of one of the big debates of the modern age, yeah. I would say. So how did religion, specifically in ancient Greece and Rome, differ from what we see with it today?
The obvious answer to that is that they had many gods, whereas we have one god. And they also had many types of gods, because when we think about the ancient gods, we tend to think of the 12 Olympians, Hermes, Athena, and so forth. But they have, rivers might be deified. They have nymphs as well. They have personified abstractions like fortune and so forth, which can actually receive worship. So that's one of the obvious differences. But I think, that's really important, actually, that sense that the plurality of modes of belief in the divine in the ancient world makes for a much more sort of flexible and fluid idea of what you're doing on the planet, and much more, and encourages much more experimentation with ideas. But contrast that to monotheism, where typically what you do have with monotheism is like an on-off switch, essentially. It doesn't have to be this way, but often people present monotheism as something that, you know, you're either with us or against us, and that seems to be a very sort of restrictive way of looking at the world. So that was one side of it. But the other side of it is that the Greek gods tend to be amongst amongst humanity. They tend to live in the same world as us. They live on Mount Olympus, which is a big mountain, and it wasn't scaled, its peak wasn't scaled until the early 20th century. So in antiquity, it wasn't kind of scalable, but it was part of our general ecosystem. And the ancient Greek gods were, as I say, they belonged to our world, but they also, interacted with human beings, and they represented at some level parts of the human world. So Dionysus represents wine and Demeter represents bread and so forth. They, these gods have many different aspects to them, but they are, they speak to human beings. They're part of our world rather than being something impossibly remote and abstract and unknowable.
Yeah, that kind of gets to something that I've heard from different authors, mostly not exactly, I guess would I would say historians, but there's this kind of debate that I run into occasionally about how exactly did these people in the ancient world view their gods? Because especially today, we encounter a lot of this stuff in popular culture through books and movies, as well as even video games. And there's, yeah, I think, kind of this conception of them as like magical figures, that they're kind of seen as sort of like, oh, there are these fun beliefs that people of the ancient world had. How seriously did people back then take things like all you've just mentioned about nymphs, as well as polytheistic deities? I mean, we know all these stories of these gods who weren't exactly, one would say, some of them moral characters or exemplars of moral virtue.
Yeah, well, in many of the earliest Greek myths, the gods don't seem to behave in an exactly moral way, but the Greeks also had stories about Zeus, for example, the king of the gods, was supposed to be the guardian of morality. And in Homer's Odyssey, for example, it's Zeus who says right at the beginning that what the suitors are doing in Odysseus's house is terribly wrong, and it's really important for the reestablishment of justice in the world to get Odysseus home and to set things right. So they did. I mean, it was a flexible and capacious model of divinity, but it wasn't trivial. It wasn't in any sense. Just about wacky stories about gods doing funny things. We have to remember that they sacrificed animals in front of entire cities and yes, then ate the meat afterwards. And of course, you know, this sacrificial metaphor persists into Christianity as well. You know, as I mentioned earlier, I was brought up Catholic. I was brought up with the idea of, you know, Christ sacrificed and you actually, you know, eat the blood eat the body and drink the blood of Christ and so forth. And that's real, you know, for Catholicism. So it persists. And that's pretty kind of heavy stuff if you think about the wider implications of it. So blood sacrifice is confronting you with your own mortality. It's saying that we are, as human beings, can kill animals because they're beneath us, and we offer them up to the gods above us. So I wouldn't want to see Greek religion as merely trivial comic book stuff. I think it is, you know, I think it probably did speak to people in much the same way that modern religions speak to people. But there were, as I say, there were also important differences between the two. Ancient religion was tends to be much more about the community, about the entirety of Greeks tended to cluster in city-states. There were about 1,200 city-states or whatever. And a lot of ancient religion was about the city-state speaking to each other as a community. And that, so it was much less individual, much less sort of sense that you contemplate the divine in a service or whatever. It was much more about that sense of collectivity.
Yes, and to my understanding, you could kind of get a glimpse at how seriously they did take their beliefs from the fact that it was so bound up with their society.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So if you're an Athenian, for example, the goddess Athena is absolutely indispensable to your sense of what you are about as an Athenian. That's not to say that people didn't have very heterogeneous beliefs and understandings about what Athena actually meant and how real she was and so forth. But yeah, I mean, these rituals, one of the other distinctions that people make between ancient Greek religion and modern religion is the heavily ritualized nature of it. People distinguish between religions that are based on the act of doing and modern religions, which are based on the act of belief, if you like. I don't think this is a watertight distinction. I think a lot of modern religion, for example, is really essentially about the community and essentially about tying people together through shared acts of ritual. But it's, in a way, it has a certain truth to it, that opposition.
So atheists, you've already kind of mentioned the new atheists, but there are some who, like theists, seem to like to latch on to historical figures who they label as their own, when, in fact, doing a little bit of digging sometimes reveals that these individuals were not really atheists in most senses of the term. Yeah. And so an example from the ancient world that I can think of would be Epicurus. One of the earliest formulations of the problem of evil has been attributed to him, but his remarks and some of his own writings seem to indicate a more deistic, or I guess you could maybe even say polytheistic view of the gods and the divine. So to what extent is the atheism that you document in your book kind of like, I guess you could say, a broad sort of skepticism, or is there more of a spectrum of unbelief that does kind of bridge into what we call atheism, as in just the disbelief in gods today?
There's certainly a spectrum of disbelief, and just as ancient Greek religion was polytheist and multiform and so forth, so ancient Greek atheism had many different varieties. So it's a really good question that you ask, whether all of these people are atheists. What I would say is we shouldn't believe that we own the term atheist, which is actually an ancient Greek term in the first place. The word atheos means the absence of a god, and it was from the probably the late 5th century onwards, 5th century BCE, this is onwards, applied to people who held that sort of philosophical belief that there were no gods. So, but it was used with great flexibility. So the Epicureans, for example, were repeatedly accused of being atheists, to the extent that the modern Hebrew term, I gather, for an atheist is apikoros, which is derived from the Greek word Epicurus. So what the Epicureans thought about the gods is to put my scholarly hat on for a second, I mean, it's much contested. There are different versions in different scholarly accounts. But I would say that the Epicureans did accept a form of divinity. But the thing about Epicureanism is that it's a form of radical materialism. Everything is made of either matter or gap. Void, the void between different atoms. The Epicureans come up with, well, they don't come up with, but they popularize the idea of everything being made out of atoms. And they thought that the same of the gods as well, that the gods are material beings and they don't exist in our world. They seem to exist in the gaps between worlds. And this is, again, it's a very difficult kind of area. It's not absolutely clear what they thought about them, but they certainly don't have any impact on our world at all. You can pray to a god all you like, but they won't listen to you. They won't answer you. They don't have any capacity to impact on our world, except occasionally through sort of dreams or something like that, where they don't tell you necessarily anything about the future or anything, but they just sort of appear because they're made of these sort of really tiny little particles. So we can occasionally glimpse them. So there was a Roman Epicurean called Lucretius who wrote this amazing poem on the nature of things that Stephen Greenblatt has argued the rediscovery of Lucretius's poem was the kickstart for the Renaissance in his book The Swerve, this very successful book that he wrote recently. And Lucretius, whilst cleaving to the Epicurean position that there are gods, also argues very heavily against the belief in traditional religion. He says that he takes the example of Agamemnon, who, a mythical king Agamemnon, who reportedly killed a stag that was sacred to Artemis, and therefore the Greek fleet en route to Troy was beached at a place called Aulis. And according to myth, he had to sacrifice his daughter in order to appease Artemis. And Lucretius says, what a terrible model. I mean, isn't that about the worst kind of moral paradigm that you could possibly get, where you actually have to kill your own daughter in order to please a deity? What, I mean, how could you possibly imagine a world like that? And he comes up with this famous line, such is the extent of evil that religion encourages us to believe in. And this is as I say, it's a really famous line that people like Voltaire cited repeatedly. But I think that kind of qualifies people for Epicureans for a flexible definition of atheism. They believe in remote gods. They believe in gods that have nothing to do with our world. They think that essentially you can get by perfectly well without gods in our world. And they also think that conventional established religion is really bad for you psychically. You could quibble that, you know, they probably do have a sort of conception of divinity, you know, but sort of stuck way out there. But essentially, that's entirely compatible with modern ideas of atheism.
Sure. Can you think of any figures from the ancient world who were maybe a little bit closer to, I mean, to my knowledge, that's been kind of one of the areas in antiquity that's been a little bit more lacking, is this idea of, okay, well, they don't believe in any gods, just period. Is there anybody that even comes maybe a little bit closer to that than the Epicureans or Lucretius?
Yeah, certainly. So in the 5th century BCE in Athens, you get a cluster of people who are known as atheists, known as atheoi. So as ever, you know, scholarly hat on and so forth, we have to be cautious about the evidence and so forth. But the ancients believed them to not believe in the gods. And in fact, actually, there was a law passed in Athens in about 432 BC, promulgated by a hyper-religious person who was mocked by his peers, and particularly by the comic poets, for being obsessed with religion and obsessed with silly dances and dancing to drums and that sort of thing. And this law was against those who didn't believe in the gods. The Greek word is a phrase of men or mitzaintus, theus, not believing in the gods. And this, it seems to have had both a negative effect in the sense that it created a category in law that could be used to prosecute people who held heretical views about the gods, and including Socrates. Socrates fell foul of exactly the same decree. But it also seemed to have catalyzed a generation of people who actually explored ideas of radical disbelief. And now, again, I always have to say that, you know, the evidence is difficult, but Protagoras, the sophist Protagoras, I would say, argued that there were no gods, because Protagoras had a view of the world that said that you can only know things if you can perceive them, and you can't perceive gods. You have no proof for gods. Therefore, for you gods don't exist. Then there was another guy called Prodicus who argued for the cultural constructiveness of religion. He thought that people lived in a primitive world originally, where they didn't understand the world around them very much. And when they first emerged out of that world and they started getting things like agriculture and wine and so forth, they named these with names of gods. And that's how religion emerged. And again, you know, different scholars would disagree about this. But I think the pivotal figure here is this really shadowy but very endlessly intriguing figure, a guy called Diagoras of Milos. There were people who didn't believe in any gods whatsoever in antiquity, and that it was both a historically localizable phenomenon in the sense that in Athens from the 420s or so onwards, we can see people who are, I would say, genuine atheists in the modern sense, people who don't believe in any gods whatsoever. And we can also see compendia of arguments against the existence of gods later on.
So atheism in the modern world is largely associated with this movement called New Atheism, spearheaded by the likes of Richard Dawkins, Sam Harris, and the late Christopher Hitchens. This New Atheism, kind of like you've already talked about, is distinguished, I guess, from old atheism, maybe in the stridency of its tone. So can you talk a little bit about how this contrasts with atheism in the ancient world? You've kind of already given some hint about maybe there were some atheists in that time who held pretty strong views of disbelief.
Yeah, I think that's right. But because they were living in a world in which you don't have religious leaders insisting that you must believe in this kind of way. At least you don't have until the 4th century CE when Christianity becomes the dominant religion of empire. And that point, you know, they really sort of it starts publishing laws saying you've got to not just believe in the Christian God, but you've got to believe in the Christian God in the correct way and so forth. But before then, there's really this relatively little by way of forcing people to believe in things in an established way. So that does give a room, does give a certain amount of room for experimental ideas. And it does mean that, I mean, you might take a dialogue, someone like Cicero, who is not usually thought of as a anti-establishment figure, but he writes a dialogue on the nature of God in which a number of different views are canvassed about what the gods are actually like from a number of different philosophical perspectives, including the possibility that the gods don't exist at all. And nobody jumps up and down and says, you know, Cicero, you're a terrible, evil person for including that possibility in your dialogue. As I say, it's a world in which philosophical explorations of the nature of divinity can take many different forms.
Did you come across much in your research on how ancient atheists were treated in the cultures that they lived in? You've kind of mentioned a little bit of that already, but was there... because I know from my own research and study that Christians were actually... ancient Christians in the culture they lived in were called atheists and weren't particularly liked, from what I've heard, by the ancient Romans. Were more general atheists treated much differently than, I guess, your average believer?
Well, I mentioned earlier, and this may have got swallowed into the bit where the Skype connection cut out, but I mentioned earlier that there was a law promulgated in Athens in about 432 BC that banned those, or that threatened severe consequences for those who didn't believe in the gods. So there was a window when Athens, which, you know, we tend to think of as pretty progressive and radical democracy and so forth, when Athens actually did seemingly persecute atheists, not many of them, but the most famous victim of that was Socrates. So there were moments when it was very difficult and dangerous to be an atheist, but in general, that wasn't the case so much. Now, when it comes to early Christianity, it's a really difficult area, this, because it seems, I mean, there certainly were persecutions of Christians, and the Romans were not averse to persecuting all sorts of people, actually. But most of our evidence for the persecution of Christianity comes after the Christianization of the Roman Empire, and it comes in the form of these martyr acts, these celebrations of the day in which X or Y was martyred for the faith. So they're actually sort of propagandistic texts. And some people, again, you know, scholars, this is the great thing about ancient history, that we can have people look at things from different angles. Some people see these texts as pretty propagandistic and ideologically charged texts that may have very little relation to reality, and other people take them as something closer to historical truth about the Romans' repression of Christianity. One thing I would say is that what you mentioned about the Christians being called atheists, that is almost entirely, that I think there's one ancient text that doesn't fit this paradigm, and even that, I think there are other ways of reading it, almost entirely a Christian claim.
Interesting.
Christians like the idea that Romans called them atheists, and then they typically, the way that the story typically goes is they call us atheists, but they're the real atheists. So it's in a way, it depends how cynical you want to be, but in a way, if you've taken the cynical reading of it, you could say that Christianity invokes the idea that the Romans called them atheists in order to flip that around and call the Romans atheists. And that's actually one definitional change that is really evident that comes in from the early 1st century CE onwards, is that atheism in certain contexts ceases to mean a philosophical belief in the absence of gods and starts meaning somebody who doesn't like my God. And that's a very, it starts at the first attestation of that meaning is in a Jewish writer, Philo of Alexandria. But the Christians really kick in with that, with the idea that an atheist is somebody who doesn't believe in the Christian God. They can believe in any number of other gods, but they're an atheist because they don't believe in the Christian God.
Yeah, and there's some objection today to this common thing that you hear from especially the new atheists about, I just believe in one less God than you. I guess apparently that was a little bit different back then.
Yes, it's a nice line.
Were there any particularly interesting accounts for you personally of atheists in that time period that really kind of stood out to you among the others?
You mean in late antiquity or?
Yes.
Yeah. Well, the works of Lucian are always good fun. Lucian was a second century satirist from Comagene, which is in modern Turkey, and it's very close to the Syrian border. I've actually visited that area, beautiful area, but obviously very, very difficult position at the moment with the Syrian refugee crisis. So Lucian was antiquity's most cynical wit, and he's endlessly generating these squibs against the gods and against the possibility of belief in the gods. And there's one dialogue that he comes up with called Zeus the Tragedian. And it's called Zeus the Tragedian because it opens with Zeus in full tragic flow saying, you know, the world is terrible, blah, 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 you know. Another god comes to him and says, why is the world so terrible, Zeus, tell me about it. And he says, well, basically we're being argued out of existence by an Epicurean on Earth. So the gods decide that they have to go and listen to this argument, and it's an argument between an Epicurean, who doesn't believe in the gods at all, doesn't believe in divine providence, and a Stoic who does believe in gods and does believe that the gods have a providential care for humanity's well-being. So the argument proceeds, and initially the gods think, that's great, it's going really well, because the Stoic seems to be okay. But after a while, the Stoic starts getting tired, and the Epicurean starts weighing him down. And it's a wonderful, it's a wonderfully sort of witty version of things, because the gods are fearful, ultimately, that they will be argued out of existence by the power of philosophical reasoning. And so, you know, the gods are there, and they're listening to it. But in this comic fiction, they are potentially vaporizable by philosophical argument.
So how do you see your work making a difference to how people understand and interact with atheists today? Do you kind of feel if it's been easier for people to dismiss atheism when it's considered a recent phenomenon? That seems to be something that, at least in my encounters with apologetics, is often something that seems to get brought up is, you know, where were these atheists building the hospitals and all this stuff that we religious people built?
Part of the aim, as you quite rightly identified, part of the aim of the book was to argue that atheism is available any place, any time. We're not, as Karen Armstrong, for example, has argued, we're not by nature essentially religious beings, and there's no stigma. There should be no stigma attached to people that don't have a belief in a deity. That was part of the beef of the book. I focus on Greece and Rome, as I mentioned earlier, partly because, you know, I'm a specialist in this area and I love the civilizations of ancient Greece and Rome, but partly also because they are our best recorded ancient societies by some distance. You can tell a similar sort of story for China or India as well. They do have material that fits into this pattern, but it's much more complex and it's much more, and as I say, it's not really my area. So that idea that atheism is not something that is new, it's not something that is necessarily deficient, or it's not a pathology of modern civilization, that was really important for me when writing the book. But I think the take-home message that I'd want to give really is this thing about classical antiquity saw a transition from a very plural world in which every single city in the Greek world, for example, I mentioned earlier 1,200 separate city-states. Every single one of these had their own form of religion, but they coexisted because they recognized that religion was open-ended and it had many different varieties, including, as I say, disbelief. But, you know, had, you know, you have your God, I have my God. And when they went to other countries, they went to Egypt or something, and they'd say, okay, well, so you're Ptah is equivalent to our Hephaestus, and that's okay. You know, we can work that out. So they didn't have the sense of religion as a site of conflict that we do now. And I think our idea of religion that we have in the modern world was forged in eras where religions were very much tied to nation states, and you could assume a kind of unity. And if you didn't have that kind of unity, well, you just can persecute the, you know, the Jews or the Catholics or whatever, you know, until they sort of disappeared and you had that unity. But we don't live in a world like that anymore. We live in a massively interconnected world in which all sorts of people believe all sorts of things, not just about religion. They also believe all sorts of wacky things about, you know, the about trickle down economics or whatever. You know, there are all sorts of, as I say, bizarre, unsubstantiated beliefs that people have. And I think we need to recapture some of that sense of living in a plural world. If that means some diminution of the state power of monotheism, I think that would be the, I'm not saying that my book will necessarily achieve that, but I hope my book is a kind of a push in that direction so that we can really accept that our beliefs are, you know, local to ourselves, but they don't necessarily erase the legitimacy of other people's beliefs.
Well said. What do you have coming up in the future then? Are there plans to continue with looking at religion and unbelief, or are you kind of moving back towards the ancient world in general?
Well, I'm doing a number of things at the moment, but one of the perhaps the most interesting thing for your listeners would be I'm writing a piece on the borders of Europe, and I'm trying to argue in this, it's again influenced by the Syrian refugee crisis that we have in Europe, and these sort of hundreds of thousands of displaced people on the borders of Europe, and millions of course in Syria itself and in Turkey, and trying to think about why and how we've got into this way of habit of thinking that if the refugees are in Turkey, somehow, you know, they're not our problem, but the minute they cross, you know, 30 miles west onto one of the Greek islands, and suddenly this is some sort of great sort of issue. So I'm trying to think about, as I say, about the traversability of those borders and where it came from, this sense that continents are markers of geophysical but also political actuality.
Well, Dr. Whitmarsh, thank you so much for coming on the show.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a real pleasure.
I'd like to thank Professor Whitmarsh for coming on the show. If you'd like to find out more about him, you can access his website at classics.cam.ac.uk/directory/professor-tim-whitmarsh. His Twitter handle is at @TWHITTERMARSH, and you can find his books, including Battling the Gods, at sites such as Amazon, Barnes & Noble, or iBooks. These links will also, of course, be included in the description to this episode at godlesshaven.com. At godlesshaven.com, you can also find out more about the show, more about myself, and plenty of additional content. Music in the show is my own work. Thank you for listening, and please join me again in the not-too-distant future for another episode of Armchair Atheism.